Hello everyone, and welcome to the 11th tutorial in our series. In the previous tutorial, we learnt of the existence of objects, also known as instances, and we learnt how to manipulate and change some of their properties. We also learnt a few new data types, such as the vector3, color3, and enumItem data types. In this tutorial, we'll dive deeper into instances and look into their methods, also known as functions. So what do we mean by method when we talk about objects? If you look back at how objects or instances belong to particular classes, for example, the base plate belongs to the part class, just like a magical RPG, these classes come with their own skills. For example, parts have an ability to clone themselves. They also have an ability to destroy themselves, and these abilities are known as methods. To use an object's method, all you have to do is index the object with a colon and the method name and add some parentheses at the end, because methods are just functions. Let's try to use the clone method of a part. We can start off by creating a part in our code using instance.new, set its position to vector3.new 0, 5 and 0, enable the anchored property, and finally set its parent to the workspace. Now let's create a clone of the part. So we index it with a colon and then type the method we want to use, which is simply clone. Don't forget to add the parentheses at the end. So this should create a clone of our part. All that's left is to store it in a variable. Before you test the code, I'll set the position of the clone to something different so we can easily spot it. Maybe vector3.new 0, 5 and -5. I'll also change the original part's name to A and the clone's name to B. Now let's test the code. We don't see it. Let's check the explorer to make sure the clone isn't hiding somewhere. It's not here either. Let's look back at our code. Can you spot why we don't see our clone? We didn't set the parent of the clone to anything, so it'll be nil. Clones don't share the same parent property with their originals by default, so we need to set the property ourselves. And now if you test the code, it should work fine. Perfect.
After a few seconds, let's get rid of the original part with its destroy method. We can add a 2-second wait and then call part colon destroy. We can add a print statement after it too, saying original destroyed. Now let's test it. And it's gone. So the destroy method is useful whenever you want to get rid of an object. Let's add another script to service script service. I'll name the first one script1 and the second script2. In this new script, let's grab the spawn location and maybe double its size. So we do local spawn location equals workspace.spawnLocation and then spawnLocation.size equals spawnLocation.size multiplied by 2. So spawnLocation.size equals itself multiplied by 2. And that's how we can double a value. Let's test the code. And there we go, the spawn location size changed. Let's try the same thing with the clone part, which we create in script 1. I'd set its name to B, so I'm going to change workspace.spawnLocation to workspace.b. And if you'd like, you can change the variable name to something else, like part or b, so it's easier to understand. Now let's run the code. It didn't work for me. I got an error. It says B is not a valid member of workspace in script 2 at the first line. You can ignore the blue text for now. So this error message tells us that when this first line was running in script 2, at that time there was no object called B inside the workspace, so it was not a valid member. When you try to index an instance with the name of a child that doesn't exist, you'll get an error like this. And whenever you receive an error from a script, the script stops running. But if you check the explorer now, we can see there is a part in the workspace called B. This means that when the game started, script 2 began running before script 1 added the clone to the workspace. However, this timing between the scripts isn't always guaranteed. If you keep rerunning the game, sometimes you'll see script 2 start before script 1 adds the part, so you get the error. and other times you'll see script 2 start after script 1 adds the part, so then the code works fine. To avoid this problem, we have two ways to go about it. The first way is to check if the clone exists in the workspace with an if statement before making any changes to it. And the second way is to wait enough time for the clone to spawn in. So for the first solution, we can do if workspace. Now, if you just do something like if workspace.b is not equals to nil, we'll still receive the same error saying b is not a valid member of workspace because we indexed workspace with a non-existent child. To avoid that, we can use a method which all instances have called FindFirstChild. This method checks if a child with the specific name you pass to it exists in an object. If that child exists, it'll return that child, but if it doesn't exist, it'll simply return nil and not an error. So instead of workspace.b, we can do local part equals workspace colon FindFirstChild b. Then if part is not equals to nil, then part.size equals part.size multiplied by 2, else, so otherwise, print b doesn't exist yet. And end. And now if we keep testing the code, sometimes we'll see the part size change without issue, and other times we'll see a message in the output saying b doesn't exist yet, without any errors. So the script runs fine. As a side note, if you pass true as a second argument to FindFirstChild, the function looks for a match in all of the descendants of the object, not just its direct children. So if you set the clone's parent to the base plate instead, the FindFirstChild method will still find the clone, because it's still a descendant of the workspace. But if we remove the second argument from FindFirstChild again, it won't check all the descendants of the workspace, so it'll return nil now. As for the second solution we mentioned, it was to wait enough time for the clone to spawn in. We can achieve this with a different method called WaitForChild. And as the name suggests, it simply waits until a child with a specific name is found in an object. So we can swap out FindFirstChildB for WaitForChildB. And now the first line should always wait until B is added to the workspace, so we won't see the string B doesn't exist yet in the output anymore. If you try to wait for a child that will never exist, the code will keep waiting, and after 5 seconds, it gives a warning in the output. For example, we could try waiting for a child called C. Since we never add a child called C to the workspace, the code will keep waiting, and after 5 seconds, it adds an orange warning to the output, saying infinite yield possible on workspace wait for child C. However, if you pass a maximum number of seconds to wait for as a second argument, the function will wait until that amount of time passes, and if the child still doesn't exist, it will return nil, but it won't give a warning, and this can be very useful. The final method we'll look at is, oddly enough, called GetChildren. Let's say we have a folder of parts, and we want to change each part's colour to something like red. Normally, we'd have to find each part in the folder individually and change its colour, but this is very tedious. There's a much simpler way, and that is by using the getChildren method, which returns an array of all the children in an object. So let's test it out. First we'll grab the folder, so local folder equals workspace.folder, and then we'll grab the parts with getChildren. Local parts equals folder colon getChildren. And don't forget the parentheses. Now let's print out the parts and see what it shows. So print parts. Let's test it. And it shows an array with all the children of the folder. Now we can loop over this array with a generic for loop and change each part's color. So for, the first variable can be index, and the second variable can be part. In parts, do, and now we can change their colors. So part.color equals color 3 from RGB, and I'll just choose a reddish color. Let's test the code. There we go, all the parts colors changed. And now we can add as many parts to the folder as we like, and the code will handle all of the colors for us. And there are many other methods of instances that you can learn. I'll add a link to the documentation for parts in the description so you can check them out. But again, you don't have to memorize all of them right now. You'll pick them up when and as you need them, but it's just useful to know where you can find them listed. If you're unsure on how to use these docs to learn what properties and methods an object has, all you need to do is firstly search the class name of the object in the search bar. I'll just look for part. Then you click on the option that says class at the top. This opens up the documentation for the part class. You can scroll down to where it says summary, and this section shows you which properties and methods the part class has. Now, most classes inherit their properties and methods from other existing classes, so they have been separated into different sections, depending on which class they've been inherited from. But this will only make sense once we learn more about classes and start to make our own in the near future. For now, all you need to know is that you can click on a section and it will drop down a list of methods or properties the part class has, or whichever class you're looking at. So if we look at the properties inherited from instance, we can see that the part class has a name property, class name property, parent property, etc. And if we look at the methods inherited from instance, we see that the part has a clone method, destroy method, a find first ancestor method, which returns the first ancestor of the object whose name property is equal to the given name. And the given name is just whatever you pass to it in the parentheses. And there are many, many other methods which you can see. If a method says deprecated, like it says here for remove, that means the method is outdated and no longer encouraged by Roblox to use in your work. Usually, deprecated stuff still works, but Roblox provides an alternative whenever they decide to deprecate something. So for remove, which sets the object's parent to nil, its alternative is destroy, which also sets the object's parent property to nil. So if you ever want to get rid of an instance, you should always use its destroy method instead of its old remove method. And if you ever need more detail about a property or method, if you click on it and if the docs worked properly, it should have taken you to the bottom of the page where it explains them in more detail. So if you open up the methods inherited from instance section and look for FindFirstChild, it gives you a lot more detail about the method and some code examples. But don't worry if you don't understand everything the docs are saying. That's what these tutorials are for, to make everything easier to understand. That's all for this lesson. I hope you understood everything, and if not, you can always look back. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask them in the comments section and I'll try to respond as soon as I can. As for an assignment, try to slowly fade the transparency of an object. This will require more knowledge from the previous lesson's content. And if you're feeling adventurous, try to build on that and make a part which turns everything it touches invisible. You'll need to find a particular method which will help you. Thank you all for watching. I hope you all have a wonderful day and I'll see you in the next one.